completion and how the user is moving through the e-learning content. So it has tools that let the learner interact also with the instructor and also with the content, not only the instructor but with the content also, and that is the key basically. So to have an understanding, essentially, you know, all LMS learning is actually e-learning, but not all e-learning is done on LMS. So, for example, any educational material you consume online, like YouTube tutorials, is an e-learning. But most people have used e-learning very informally at some point in their lives, even if they don't realize that they have used it. So, of course, when you are running an L&D company or an organization or business, it doesn't make much sense, you know, just to put the content online. You put the material online and tell the employees go and complete it. So it doesn't work that ways. You need to create a content itself, send it out to the learners, track completion, and build a community around it. So this is where an e-learning on LMS comes in. So that's the significance. LMS offers a lot of features which, you know, enables the e-learning. So, like, you know, there is a leadership board. So all the learners can see their scores, that how they are faring in terms of the courses. They have access to the study groups or their peer groups also in form of these leadership boards. There are message boards also through which they can interact with their instructor. They can email their queries to the instructor, or even, you know, there are certain LMSs which have chatbots or chat rooms also. The features are there. Then there are certain social media features, like, you know, there is a like button, like you have liked the course, and there is a comment button. So, like, you can comment on the course also. So, which is, you know, very, very interactive and very, very responsive. And then there is a whole lot of assessment framework in the LMS. So, with features like these, you know, then the e-learning becomes really, really interesting. And actually, the meaning of e-learning comes to its true essence, learning at your own pace and at your own time. So, what I will say is, like, you know, LMS is like OTT platform, right? And your e-learning program or module are like the movies. The movie content needs to be interesting and entertaining enough to pull the viewership in an OTT. And same is the case with e-learning. So even your e-learning program or content is there on the best of the LMS, but if it is not creative enough to pull the you can say pull or hold the interest of the learner, it is not going to suffice its purpose. So certain factors we will talk about today, that, you know, how to make the content that, you know, that intrigued content, that interesting content. So, you know, there are certain things which we have to look at while we are creating it. So the content must be creative. It has to be interactive. And the most important thing is the curiosity quotient. If there is a curiosity quotient in your content, then trust me, the learner will hold on and will have the interest to move forward, because he's doing the learning on his own. It's kind of self-learning he's doing. He's not being supervised like it is on the virtual platforms. So curiosity quotient is very, very important, because the learner span these days is very less. The attention span is not more than 2 to 3 minutes. So this is an important factor. We will talk about it also. And then the e-learning content has to be very rewarding. So while, you know, he's doing something and he's crossing levels, so there has to be certain rewards at each level to make the learner stay. So enough to pull up and keep the interest of the learners. So we'll talk about the key factors which can make your content little creative. The first factor I will talk about, in all my projects, I especially take utmost care of the visual appeal of the content. So because, you know, the visual experience of the learner is very important, because you can actually, you know, capture your audience immediately with attractive visuals. And these visuals have a lot of things like, you know, the color contrast you are using. So especially when I'm doing a project for my client, for example, if I do it for HDFC Bank or if I do it for Kotak, so I will use the color theme which is according to the organization. I'm designing the program. So you can pick up a color theme. And you know, don't just let your audience judge your content by, you know, that it is looking very plain. The visual effects really adds on to it. And after color contrast, another thing which is very important is repetition. You know, it's basically, you know, in ID, in instructional design, we always use this, that repetition is one of the basic fundamentals. So if you are using some shape, size, some texture or something, you know, repeat it. Because, you know, what happens that creating a cohesive and organized feeling in the user's mind is very, very important while you are creating your learning content. So make sure, you know, all your fonts, your weight, size, and everything is spread uniformly and they are same throughout the course. So that is one thing which is very important. And then alignment and balance, that, you know, how much visual weightage of each thing, of each object and things are in a specific area. Now we'll talk about the most important thing I mentioned, that, you know, the content should have a meaningful interaction. And what do I mean by meaningful interaction? Now, once you have grabbed the user with your visual appeal, right? Now you have made the content to make them learn your course, right? So to keep them actively engaged, you have to prioritize and interact with their, you know, the user interaction with the screen should be throughout in the course or the module, whatever you are presenting. So there are certain strategies which generally I do in my projects is to make a meaningful interaction. The first thing is discovery. You know, basically we humans, we are naturally inquisitive and we like to discover it on our own. So the users are excited and tempted to discover new things. Instead, you know, we can add elements like visual content and media and, you know, questions, a clear-cut message, timely, you know, leading the user to reach another level. So that kind of, you know, inquisitiveness should be there throughout in the program or the module. Then questions, very important. What kind of questions we are asking in addition to discovery? You know, we want the user to think deeply and then, you know, attempt the questions. The conversational content never fails to... So it's like very important to, you know, ask engaging questions and randomly, so that, you know, he is not he's not preempting ki ye question abhi aayega. Nee, it has to be random. And that surprise element, as shared by Dilip and Hari, the surprise element should be there. So let them get involved personally. A user, when he gets involved personally, does a critical thinking, and then he discovers and finds an answer to a question. That's the way, you know, if the content is being conceptualized and designed, actually keeps the learner's interest. Then there is another thing, which is problem solving. So whatever e-learning content I have designed, if there is some problem which I have given to the user, and what happens then, you know, the interactions becomes more meaningful, whatever knowledge he has acquired in that session. And it makes them feel very related to their experience. And it's like, you know, at this point, you can give them a purpose or a reason to start or continue the course. And lure even reluctant learners. If there is a problem-solving element in your e-learning content, the reluctant learners also, you know, think about how to solve a simple problem they actually face in a real life. So that's how, you know, you can hook the learners. So problem-solving element is another thing I wanted to share. And yes, of course, contextual relevance is very, very important. So what we do is we create real life scenarios that are associated with a problem or the context to motivate them to solve it. I'll share certain examples of the projects which I've done for my clients also, where, you know, we brought in the contextual relevance and in gamification. I'll talk about gamification also, just in short. And so for example, in contextual relevance, every industry has certain processes and their employees are expected to execute or supervise the processes at different level. So the now application of these processes in different real life scenarios can be learned very well through e-learning. You know, you can break it down into decision points, then consequence, then how to overcome the objections, and finally, you know, coming on to a reward point. So that is how, you know, these contextual relevance has to be kept in mind. And all of this can be done very well through gamification these days. We must have, you know, heard about gamification. I'll talk about two things in this gamification and game-based learning. And I'll talk about what are these two and what is the difference and how both of them can be used as per the learner's need or as per the organizational need. So, you know, gamification is something which is very deeply rooted in the human psychology. We love to, you know, compete and score points and do all of that and succeed. That feeling, that small feeling of achievement we get. So accordingly, what we do is the courses are designed in a way that it challenges the learners to move forward in the learning. So in gamification, what happens is that, you know, the entire content is gamified. So for example, you know, okay, I'll give an example, very relatable example. Like I had to teach my daughter elementary addition, right? So what I did that I told her ki bacha main aur tum na ek game khelenge, mama aaj aapke saath ek game khelegi, hum aur aap 5-5 addition ke sum solve karenge, dekhte hain aap zyada jaldi karte ho ki mama karti hai aur kitne correct honge. So it's like, you know, what I did, I packaged the learning, the entire content, and I made it look like a game where the learners were competing. We had a score. So this is like, you know, gamifying the content is gamification. We can do with any content. You know, the content is ready with you. You can add gamification to the content which is readied with you, or you can even prepare new content keeping gamification in mind. And there are different tools. You can also make use of different tools that are easily available to do this. And at least start adding gamification elements to your courses. So I'll just share about, you know, common gamification tools. There is a leadership board. You know, it is one of the ways to make your learners competitive. What is a leadership board? It is nothing. It's a scoreboard. So it's like, you know, all the learners, they can see each other's score, and they can see, you know, and they would like to, you know, have a competitive edge, beat the other person, be on the top, or, you know, so it is considered one of the most competitive gamification leadership board. And the idea behind this is that they gain a recognition among the group or the community, and they like to be praised. So that's one feature of gamification. And then you can add elements of points also. Elements of points is what, you know, it motivates the user. So the points can also be used to unlock, you know, the next level of course, or anything that represents a progress. So you can keep points also. And then there are certificates and badges, which you can include in the e-learning programs. So, which is very, very important in gamification or e-learning. If you wanted to provide something of worth from gamification, you can provide a tangible reward such as a valid certificate or a badge. So, you know, these certificates, badges, they make more sense and can be incorporated. And it's like, you know, the sense of achievement goes up. The worth of their time goes up that, you know, yes, I've completed a course. And you also give certificate for a price with an expiry date also, if you want. You know, that's again something which is a very organizational need based thing. So then you can also keep collectibles. You know, collectibles is nothing any human enjoy, like, you know, enjoy collecting items. So you can keep collectibles in your games to make it more interactive and social. And they are very advanced gamification tools like, you know, course currency. So it's like, you know, their money is a real motivator. It's kind of a virtual currency which a person creates for a course. And Bitcoin was designed like that only. It was kind of a virtual currency which was given to users for a gamification, for a game-based learning program. Then further, it had its own journey of getting into a cryptocurrency, and it is widely being used. So kind of virtual currencies you can also create to keep that in interest. So now I've spoken about the gamification. I've spoken about the features of gamification. And now I will talk about the game-based learning. So I gave you an example of my daughter that if I have to teach her elementary addition. So what I did, I packaged the content in a game manner to her. Using the same example, if I have to teach elementary addition, what I can do is I can design a snake and ladder game, right? Snakes and ladder game where, you know, at every number, at every point when the dice is making you move forward, you have to do certain addition. And only then you will move forward. So what will happen? The ladders will be, you know, they will take you upward. You have to add those many points. And the snake is, if you have given a wrong answer, you'll come back. So for example, you design a game and the learning is integrated inside that game. Is called game-based learning. So there is a difference between the two. And the integration of these game mechanics with the training content actually, you know, brings out the game-based learning. And in game-based learning environment, what happens that users, you know, learns new concepts. And the best part about the game-based learning is you can practice your skill as many times as you want. And you can create your individual scores and compete against it. So, you know, some common, the progress in the game is also directly related to the understanding of the subject being taught. So there are a lot of common applications in organizations like customer service training, policy review, company training, you know, staff awareness training. So all of these can be built into game-based learning as well. So there are two ways to implement these game-based learning. One is you can use games that you already have to support your content, or besides you can purchase also, you know, are available. There are a lot of platforms which offer you this. And there are vendors also which provide these things for you and it saves your cost and time and money. Effort to build a game on your own from scratch. So you can share your idea, you can give your Big Rock idea, and the conceptualization of that idea can be discussed with the vendor, and they can further, you know, share with you their module of GBL, that's game-based learning. So what I will share is that, you know, game-based learning and gamification are different, and at the end, and what happens, another challenge which I have seen and observed, that while we are doing any, we are adding any game element, what happens ki kai baar hamara game alag chal raha hota hai, hamara content alag chal raha hota hai ek game mein, ya content na patches mein aa raha hota hai game mein. So the e-learning thing of the game has to marry very well with the learning you want to deliver to your learner. तो ये जो चीज है ना, दिस हैज टू बी वेरी वेल थॉट ऑफ एट द टाइम ऑफ यू नो व्हेन यू आर डिजाइनिंग एंड प्रायोरिटाइजिंग एंड ऑर्डरिंग योर ई लर्निंग कॉन्टेंट. सो बेसिकली यू नो दिस इज द चैलेंज विच आई हैव सीन इन लॉट ऑफ ई लर्निंग मॉड्यूल्स एंड लॉट ऑफ गेम बेस्ड मॉड्यूल्स, दैट द गेम एलिमेंट इन सम मॉड्यूल्स द गेम एलिमेंट इज वेरी हाई, द लर्निंग वॉज वेरी लो. In some modules, what happens? The learning was very high, लेकिन मजा ही नहीं आया. Game खेला लेकिन game जैसा नहीं लगा. Feeling ही नहीं आई कि game खेला हमने. So you know, both of them have, there has to be a very good marriage actually between them. So that is something which needs to be taken care of while you are creating your own e-learning content. So I'll share certain examples from my own projects. What I did is we designed a game-based training module for one of our clients to help them introduce the basic concepts and acronyms used in their organization to their newly joined managers in their induction program. So it was like a bingo game. You know, they have to do, if you have, you know, ever played this game, bingo, it's a word game. No, kind of. So we designed, we used bingo game and we used the acronym basic concepts. We integrated both of them and the learner was playing a game and he learned the concepts. So that is how, you know, a game-based learning or an e-learning can be made very, very creative. Another thing which we made was a KYC and AML and fraud prevention. We built it in the gaming skill of a detective game for a bank. So all the employees needs to be trained on AML and KYC guidelines, but this is such a boring thing to do. You know, KYC padlo, AML padlo. Interesting manner in a game where there is a detective game and you know, you are learning and then you have your KYC scores and your certificate. So that is how we, you know, help our clients in creating engaging content. And another, we used like knowledge of another project which we made is, I'll just share about that, the knowledge of different types of funding available for entrepreneurs, which we presented through a game where you have to create an elevator pitch for the investors, right? You are trying to attract investors. So you have to create an elevator pitch. And then, you know, further, you will face investors' objections also. You handle the objections. After you handle the objections and you move on and you handle all the objections well, you finally win an investor. And he is finally funding your business. So it's kind of, you know, it gives you a very, you know, very high on simulation this is. All these things are very high simulation based. So it gives you a real experience and sense of achievement. And another HR project, which is still in discussion, we haven't developed it yet, but I'll just share the idea with you that, you know, to check on the integrity and compliance scores before hiring any employee. No, so there was a game. There is still in discussion that there is a game. We'll build a game. We'll develop a game where, you know, the user needs to take some critical decisions. Like, you know, he will cross the red light to reach early or he will not, you know, and then he's moving forward. He'll sanction a contract, which is little non-ethical, but has larger profits attached to it. So these kind of, you know, simple things is being designed into that game so that before hiring, you can have the compliance and integrity scores in hand. So these kind of ideas we have conceptualized and we have done for our clients. I just thought to share these with you. And with that, you know, I come to an end. Thank you so much, Hari. Thank you so much for giving me this awesome opportunity that I could share what I experienced as a learning and development person in past few years. Thank you so much.
Beautiful. Over to you. Thank you, Priyanka. That was really beautifully presented. And I love the comparison with the OTT platform. And that e-learning is like a movie. So many trainers like me maybe could not make it to Bollywood, but we can easily make it to the e-learning platform. Yeah. So very well said. And I just want to again request you, please make some time for HSSE. And we want to work with you to work on our e-learning content and to spruce up our e-learning platform, you know, something very close to our heart. So we look forward to working with you, Priyam. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Same here, Hari. Thank you.
For this wonderful presentation. Yes, Jui, over to you.
Yes. So without taking much time, first of all, thank you so much, Priyanka, for your valuable insights and the live examples. The real life examples actually makes a lot of difference and it makes learning easy also. A big round of applause for sharing your thoughts. And you. Next in line, we have a very special thing for all of you. It's time for the special showcase, and I would like to invite Mr. Hariharan Iyer and Mr. Dilip Sharma, both the people behind our Digital Academy. But before we move on to listen to them, I would like to play a small video which will showcase what our academy, our Digital Academy, TEDLA, is all about.